Сегашни чуем малко повече информация за един проект Smarter Together и ролята на София, който е тук за Георгиев, който ще ни представи малко повече информация. След което отново ще поканим Юдит Борско, която, както вече изяснихме, в малко повече детайли ще даде насоки за прилагането на практика на този guidance package for implementation, на базата на който ще започнем истинската работа. Така че това е в общи линии сценария за следобед. И от тук нататък до края на конференцията наистина работата ще бъде обща, съвместна с всички вас и наша помощ като фасилитатори.
So, dear guests, I will allow myself again to hold my presentation in English in order to be able to transport the planned contents in a good way. And for everyone who is presented in this call. So, I will firstly present you in a brief way our current SCC's master. Communities project Smarter Together, which up to now is the largest one in this framework, which is focused on the cooperation of three lighthouse cities, Vienna, Munich and Lyon. And the follower cities are Santiago de Compostela, Venice and Sofia. We, of course, have some observer cities, which are Kiev and Yokohama, where I should say Yokohama is quite an active partner. And there are 30 more partners from 8 countries participating in the projects, at the local projects. So what we are focusing on is a large-scale demonstration of the European 2020 targets, mainly focusing on the environmental protection, emissions reductions on the urban and regional level, implementing smart city business models, fostering job creation and business acceleration, actively pursuing user-centric innovation, establishing a holistic low energy district approach, which is my particular field of work at this project, then developing flexible and reliable next-generation district heating, creating citizens-oriented data platforms, and providing e-mobility solutions for various urban processes. So the five concrete areas of co-creation and replication are citizen engagement, district heating and renewable energy, holistic refurbishment, smart data, and e-mobility. The results we're expecting are more than 140,000 square meters of refurbished residential area and respectively a CO2 reduction of more than 50% compared to the current state, then 17.2 megawatts of newly installed renewable capacity in the districts we are working on in Vienna, Munich and Lyon. Then 50 new e-mobility solutions, saving about 100 tons of CO2 per year and over 1500 new jobs. Let's just mention what is Vienna doing in this case. I suppose the colleagues from Vienna could tell more about this. Focusing on participation and partnership in all aspects of urban renewal, energy savings and mobility. Refurbishment of about half of the total amount in the entire project of the needed refurbishment space. Living space, then using new local energy resources and ICT and developing a local mobility strategy and installation of innovative e-mobility solutions. Yes, is the right place to say Vienna is really good at the engagement of the city. Munich is focusing on the integration of multimodal mobility solutions, first of all connecting and interrelating of e-mobility to the existing types of mobility and also improving the cycling infrastructure, an open data platform for holistic city planning, and the creation of innovative smart city services. So all the three main topics of Munich, which are energy efficient housing, transportation, and social improvement, social services improvement, they all have their particular different intelligent services, which are bound into one app product, which is, I think, called Smart City App, Munich Smart City App. Then there is also policy and regulational issues, governance, yeah, user-centered solutions and wide take up of sustainability goals and business model innovation, which is also quite important for us working on the housing renovation, because we're also thinking about innovative business models in this area. Lyon is really active on the area of refurbishment of existing buildings, but also the creation of new innovative districts, then involving citizens in the redevelopment of the confluence area, which is the new area, so to say, and increasing the quality of life of inhabitants. The follower cities, as I mentioned, are Santiago de Compostela, working strongly on the improvement of the living building stock. Venice focusing a lot on the transportation issues. Venice is also taking part at our urban air mobility initiative. And Sofia focusing on the energy retrofit, integrated transportation and governance. So I'm very happy that there are colleagues from the city of Sofia here who can tell actually much more on these topics. We're working together on several of those. This is just a short overview of the partners involved in this project. So, and the topic that is particularly focused on Sofia and on the topic of energy retrofit of existing residential building, we did firstly the strategy for this in Munich, for the city of Munich and for the urban municipal company for urban renovation, and this strategy we replicated, of course, in accordance to the local conditions and needs to the city of Sofia. So, as we probably heard several times in the recent days and months, the ones who are dealing with the city of Sofia, and Bulgaria, of course, is committed to the European Union's policy for the climate protection for the Agenda 2020, and part of it is the 20% reduction of the EU greenhouse gas emissions, 20% reduction of the primary energy consumption, and 20% share of renewable energies in EU energy consumption by 2020. So that sounds very good. But the reality is that Sofia is growing, which is very good for the city, and in the same time, the demand for personal transportation, means cars, is increasing constantly. So the number of the cars is growing. In the same time, the new inhabitants of Sofia also need to live somewhere and to heat their homes. So we have a constant increase of the emissions currently. As you can see, the district heating is responsible for a very small amount of the CO2 emissions of Sofia, and a big number of it is the household waste. That's why Sofia is doing so much for dealing with the household waste and having waste power plants. The annual CO2 emissions from the car transport in Sofia is responsible for about 87% of the emissions in the transportation sector. So, as you can see here by this picture, Bulgaria is leading on top of the polluted countries with 77 micrograms per cubic meter of PM10. And Bulgarian cities, and in particular Sofia, has the highest PM2.5 concentrations, fine particle concentrations, from all the EU countries and their cities. The coal-fired power plants and heating is one of the largest sources of air pollution here. Among that, residential heating accounts for the biggest amount. As we heard from Ms. Fandakova, the mayor of Sofia, Sofia is selected as a green city target of the EU, and the following 8 indicators from the figure can be taken to measure its green performance, which is environmental governance, CO2, energy, buildings, transportation, water, waste and land use, and air quality. So regarding the CO2 emissions ranking, Sofia ranks on the last place, 29th. So the buildings rank is 14th of the efficiency, waste and land use ranks is the last possible place, the air quality of the city of Sofia is also on the last place, the 29th. And in the energy category, Sofia ranks on the 28th place. So in total, the city of Sofia is ranked on the 28th of 28th possible, so it's the last place for environmental governance. So it's a very loud alarm for all of us sitting here now that we need to combine forces, to unite forces and to work towards improving that. Of course, we take into account that several cities, and in particular Munich, has its own climate protection strategy, which is also followed in a very good way. But of course, the city also cannot follow the constant increase of the population, which is about 30,000 people per year, if I remember it in a right way, which means Munich is growing by the size of one small city annually. It means the emissions grow, and of course, the demand for housing space is growing. So what? Fraunhofer IDP, we are together with G5 and Partners, it's a consultancy company from Munich. They're doing consulting for large enterprises normally, also focused on energy efficiency and energy production. And how are we dealing together with the challenges I just mentioned? As we already saw, the building stock is responsible for a very high amount of the CO2 emissions in the city. And by itself, the biggest part of the residential part, the residential buildings in Sofia, are the so-called owner community buildings. Yeah? So that are the buildings operated by an owner community with more than two and less than, let's say, 300 members. Among the project, we are trying to, as much as possible, to communicate between the boss city and exchange experiences and lessons learned. What is the strategy we, at least, are presenting for Sofia? We are trying to address, as much as possible, buildings of the same typology, which are demanding strongly retrofit, and then we are aiming to intensify the energy reduction at these buildings, and by this to achieve the highest possible effect. But how to do that? How to achieve this quantity among owner community operated buildings? It's quite difficult everywhere in this world, including in Bulgaria and in particular in Sofia. So, what the city needs to do in order to achieve its own CO2 emissions reduction goals is to address exactly those owners and as much as possible of those owners of these apartments and the buildings through various channels, show them the advantages of energy building retrofit, convince the decision makers with facts, which means the owners with facts, and coach and support the process of decision making. In the same time, in Bulgaria currently, it's a quite efficient funding program for the retrofit of exactly such kind of buildings, which in combination with this strategy could achieve really good results. But of course, we propose also some particular improvements of this funding program. by investing a little bit of this money for the retrofit into the technical consultancy and the convincing work for the owners. So Munich has its own district information centers responsible for the information on energy retrofit, which is operated by MGS, the Munich Society for Urban Renewal, which is a city-owned company. And every district has such an office which is getting in contact with the citizens and offers information on energy retrofit. And by investing into the labor of several persons on the entire city level, the city is achieving really very good results in the retrofit development. And of course, a team of functional experts, as the colleagues here responsible for this definitely know even much better than me, is needed. Technical building experts, experts with overview on public funding options, extremely important. Experts for calculating financial effects of the retrofit and its consequences, and experts for setting up innovative financing options. And definitely this bundled experience and lessons need to be communicated constantly with the city government, with the citizens, but also with other cities in order to improve the service for the apartment owners. So, normally the retrofit process also here takes up to 5 years, where the first 2 years, up to 3 years, is actually the period of making the owners aware of what we offer to do for them, contact them, and the decision-making process. These first 2 to 3 years, they're crucial for the success of the entire process. And this is what we are focusing on, and we are also developing together at the working group the preform of a European standard. Also, Judith Bosbaum is participating very actively at the working group which I'm chairing. And we know that the owner communities have a slow and tedious decision making process, and we totally understand that they should not be underestimated, and develop a strategy how exactly to improve and make it faster, the process which we are talking about. So we developed a strategic roadmap for building efficiency improvements and the guideline for optimally allocating of public funding and establishing a funding policy. It's a white paper that was published at the end of 2017. And of course, support and sparing in setting up local building retrofit coordination entities. We know this process will get quite a while, but we are also confident that it will definitely contribute significantly for the success of the local energy efficiency improvement policy. So these are once again the partners. So once again, just for your information to see what are the main influencing factors for the energy retrofit, is the impact of users' behavior on energy consumption actually the most significant and crucial factor influencing the success of the energy retrofit actions and measures, which is very difficult to influence. Then we have the personal costs and maintenance, the materials costs, the price level for the energy, the price level for heating energy, the quality and precisions in every step of the work. So we tried to do an estimation at the pilot project in Munich based on the gas price, but of course we realized it's totally not a good approach, and we realized that the city of Munich is doing the same. They are assuming there is a 5% of increase of the gas price annually, which is not the reality. Yeah, I think in 2 minutes I will finish. Yeah. And so the price of gas even is decreasing sometimes. So the plans that the city of Munich is offering to the owners and the different scenarios for retrofit, they are not really 100% related to the reality and the gas prices and the future. So that means that the payback of the energy retrofit for many of the owners would come in 40 to 50 years, which means for us, at least by the argument of financial efficiency by energy retrofit, we cannot convince the owners. What we propose is the introduction of several different new units in the entire process, which is marked in green. And the new approach is that employees of the city or city-owned companies need to contact the homeowners to make them aware of the different opportunities for an energy retrofit. Then the homeowners need somehow to have a person, maybe from the administration advisory council, who is paid and who is taking care and responsible for the entire retrofit process. And the homeowner associations need to provide information for the administration advisory council. So there are several steps in the process, which I will not go in depth, because it takes a long time, and there are several impact factors for the decision-making process for energy retrofit, and we're focusing on those ones who are the variable factors and trying to make improvements on them. So it's the way how we did in Munich, and we are proposing to be done on another places, and another topic is also when creating the energy retrofit roadmap for a building, to think that this owner community would not be able to finance the whole measure at once. So we are developing a step-by-step plan for the building, of course in accordance to all the requirements on the technology and the building physics, which we are focusing on as well. As I already mentioned, we developed a roadmap for the city, we developed a guideline for the allocation of public funding and the improvement of the entire scheme, which needs to be coordinated with the National Ministry for Regional Development, which is responsible for the funding program for retrofit in Bulgaria. And we are ready in future to support and spare in setting up local building retrofit coordination entities similar as the ones, for example, in Munich. So, thank you for your attention, and Judith, the floor is yours.